And he would leap out and he would say, "Great Scott," the farmer would say. And Ted would say, with a flicker of amusement playing over his manly features, "Yes, that's right. Ted Scott's the name." Well, did anyone ever hear of those books, Ted Scott? Well, anyway, this plane comes sailing down, bumped twice, and landed right in... you got a bulletin coming in here? Crying out on Bulletinsville. This plane landed right in the middle of the yard, and I'm telling you, the kids are going out of their skull. Let me tell you the sight now that greeted us. This is an actual sight. The sky is lowering. It is gray. There are about 9 raindrops coming per square foot. You know, big fat drops that come plunking down. And all the kids are standing out there in their corduroy knickers. All the little chicks, Miss Shields, Miss Norton, Mr. Melton, they're all out there. There's about 4,000 kids, and right in the middle of it is a little Curtis Robin airplane. I recognize this airplane because I was a wild fan of airplanes, you know. And I read all the little model airplane books and all that, and there was a Curtis Robin. And here's what happened. I'll never forget this. The door opened, and out of this steps this guy wearing whipcord pants. He had on a goggle. He had a set of goggles, and he had one of these leather helmets and a leather jacket. And he looked exactly like the pictures, the wild pictures of Lindbergh and all that stuff, you know. I mean, these are part of the folk myth, you know, the heroic lone aviator. He is a true folk myth. He does not exist anymore, you know. I mean, a jet pilot in a great big 707 isn't the same anymore. He's Big Daddy, you know. He's Big Daddy. He's a bus driver. He's an accountant. He's all this stuff. But this was a lone aviator, and he had landed in the outfield at the Warren G. Harding School. Well, he gets out, and he stands by his airplane, and, of course, Miss Norton, who was the head of the school, took charge immediately and said, "What's the meaning of this?" And he says, "I am out of gas, madam." And this is fantastic, all of us kids. And now this shows you how different the world is. She says, "Well, you're going to have to get this airplane right out of our schoolyard. This is a private school. You cannot be, this is public property here, and we cannot have people landing airplanes. Nobody can park on this playground." She put it immediately into the relegation of parking. Well, this is how different the world is. He says, "Well, I'm going to have to get some gas, madam." And, of course, all of us kids are fainting. All the guys are falling down. Oh, great Scott, it's a real aviator. You know, it's a real one. Everybody wants to run up and touch his jacket, you know, or hold his goggles or something, because we're right in the middle of the goggle-wearing period of kids. You know, kids wearing goggles on their hats and all. Here's a guy with real goggles. You know, they were kind of green. You know, and you could see oil on the side of his airplane and big numbers, NC170609D- experimental, all that stuff. Had orange wings and it had a dark green body. Oh boy, great big disc wheels there, and we're all walking around. And immediately, of course, he had to take charge. A couple of cops come wandering over, you know, and immediately there's a sort of cordon. "All right, stay away in the plane, kids. Come on out. Stay away. Stay back now. Very dangerous. Stand back there. Stand back." And the pilot opens up the hood of the airplane, and he's looking in there. You can see, you know, all the stuff. "Oh, I'm just gassed, you know, the great big rotary engine, you know. I'm just standing there, all the kids, me and Josh Wayne Flick and all of us, where our tongues are hanging out in our eyeballs, and I'm sure that it completely changed the life of every chick in that school. It only went up to sixth grade. I'm sure that right now there are, I would say, roughly 300 girls, maybe 500 girls, who have never made it with a man, because they have a secret, fantastic image of a heroic figure that has never again come into their life. And I'll bet they can't even trace it down. To this day, they don't know why they don't make it with the piano tuner they made. You know, they just can't make it with the insurance man that they're married to. And little realizing that always what they will see, what they dream of, is this guy who was, and he looked at least 19 feet tall. Remember, after a war, only about 2.5 feet tall. And there's this guy with these leather helmets, puttees, the whole business, walking around there. The wind is blowing. Very dramatic. Well, we had this guy, Mr. Watts, who was Thomas Watts's father, was the school custodian. He's like the janitor, you know, and he was like the patriarchal guy who would come around and fill the ink wells and all that jazz and run the furnace and everything and all that sort of thing, the father confessor stuff. Well, Mr. Watts went down the street with this guy to the Texaco station, and believe it or not, they got gasoline down there. Yes, it sounds like I'm telling you the truth. They came back with about three big 5-gallon cans, and those big square cans of gasoline. They're pouring the gasoline in there. They're running it all in there. And, of course, all the kids are, oh, it's a fantastic moment here. You know? I'm just telling you exactly what happened. Can you imagine this happening in our time? Can you imagine this happening in Teaneck Well, this is what happened. So we're all standing around, and they're pouring the gas in. They got a hold of this big funnel that they got from the gas station. The gas station guy came down, and he's standing. Of course, everybody's gassing. By this time, men started to drift out of the houses, and there's about 9,000 people all standing around in the schoolyard. Guys out of work, you know, dogs and bicycles. Everybody is all standing around watching us, see? A couple of guys driving past in Humpmobiles stop. The whole shootman, the whole town is sort of drifting there. And he's walking around, you know, this heroic figure. Miss Norton is in charge of all the kids. All right, now, kids, now stand back. Don't get in the way of the aviator now. She kept calling him the aviator. Now, don't get in the aviator's way now. Now, the aviator is busy now. Be careful now. That's very dangerous. Now, Joshua, get back. Now, stand back, Alex. Now, stand back. Well, the aviator walked around, and finally he got this thing going. He got all the oil in and all the gas that he needed. He put the thing down. He battened down the hatches. And this is what he had. He had one of those big centrifugal starters. Have you ever seen a centrifugal starter? He gets in there, and he goes, and all the people are cleared away. And he whips that little plane around, and it's kicking up a wild slipstream. He goes taxiing along that pitcher's mound. He goes whipping past home plate. And it's bouncing along over the grass. He goes into a beautiful chandel over Cleveland Street, right over Cleveland Street. He goes right over the housing project. And within 30 seconds, this guy is 5,000 feet. He circles twice, wiggles his wings, and heads off into the horizon.